So first of all, thank you very much for the invitation and sorry for this delay. How much time I have?
So you can talk for 50 minutes. Again, some of us will have
okay,
to
leave. Maybe I will talk a little bit faster. But anyway, let's start. The talk is about a very classical object, a kind of entropy function of a measure. The usual entropy function, the standard one, appeared already in Segur work. And I will speak about some generalization or extension of this object. And I basically going to tell you how to use this object to prove some result in the theory of orthogonal polynomials. So we started with measure mu on the unit circle, the probability measure. To avoid some trivialities, I suppose that the measure is not a finite linear combination of point masses. So in the usual way, I define the Poisson integral of the measure. And then the main object of the talk is this function k mu of variable z. Z is a number in the unit disk. So it is defined in the following way. I consider the harmonic extension of mu
Yeah, probably the best idea would be to terminate the connection, then that way you will see that.
I don't know how to do it without removing him.
But maybe that's the best thing to do now. That way he can
he won't be able to reconnect.
Okay, right. Okay. Mm-hmm.
We cannot hear.
Roman, we cannot hear you. Still cannot hear you, sorry.
You can try to test your microphone. Zoom, there is an option to test microphone. Usually it helps.
Okay, so so I should start the presentation once again. Okay, so once again, the entropy measure, the main object of the talk, is defined here. And so the measure mu is the sum of its absolutely continuous part and the singular part. Okay, so the entropy function is this difference. And so just to look at simple properties, this is a non-negative measure because of non-negative function on the open unit disk, and because of Jensen inequality, we have identically zero entropy function, or which is the same zero value at some point, if and only if the measure mu is just the Lebesgue measure on the unit circle. This is again Jensen inequality, namely just the case where we have equality in Jensen inequality. It is also easy to see that if you take the limit when r tends to one, then this function tends to zero. Why we have such a convergence? Because, the first integral, we have a Poisson extension. So in the limit, we will have almost everywhere something like this, just the value of the weight W. And in the limit here, we will have the logarithm of W of Xi. And then when we take a logarithm of W, so in the limit, we will get zero. So this is a non-negative function, which in the open unit disk, which tends to zero almost everywhere on the unit circle. So let me now tell you how it is related to orthogonal polynomials and how to use it for orthogonal polynomials. So first of all, consider the family of orthogonal polynomials with respect to our measure mu on the unit circle. In fact, we normalize it. So these are orthonormal polynomials. So the norm is in L2 of mu is just one. Then we define the reflected polynomials, phi and star, and the so-called Segeau function of the measure mu, which is called d mu of z. So this is just an outer function with this property, this one. Okay, so Segeau theorem tells us that in the limit for every point z in the open unit disk, in the limit we have the following effect. We have the limit of phi and star of z is the inverse Segeau function at each point z in the open unit disk. So this is for every point z when n tends to infinity. This is one version of the classical Segeau theorem. Another classical fact that I'm going to prove in this talk, just to show you how to use the entropy function just introduced before, this is so-called Matteini-Vytautic theorem, quite a famous fact in orthogonal polynomial community. This is an analog of Segeau theorem for points on the unit circle. So in the unit disk, reflected orthogonal polynomials converge to the inverse Segeau function. What's going on the unit circle? So in fact, we have the following Chisara type convergence. So for almost every point xi zero on the unit circle T, the following limit exists. This one. Okay. So the proof is not easy, and somehow for almost every Xi zero, in fact, means that Xi zero should be the Lebesgue point of the weight W of its logarithm and the Hilbert transform of the logarithm. And the new proof I'm going to present actually simplifies things a little bit. Namely, we will use only assumptions that Xi zero will be the Lebesgue point of the weight W and of its logarithm. So we will not use assumption that Xi zero is the Lebesgue point of the Hilbert transform of logarithm. Okay, so a couple of words about the main ingredients of the proof. One of the main facts we will use is so-called Khrushchev formula in the theory of orthogonal polynomials. For this, I need to define a so-called Schur function of the measure mu, another classical object. So we consider the Poisson extension of the measure mu, and it turns out it is very easy to check that this Poisson extension is, it's actually more or less evident. It is a positive harmonic function, and therefore it is a real part of some fraction of this form. And this is equivalent on the description actually for some analytic function f in the unit ball of H infinity space. So this function f is called the Schur function of the measure mu. In fact, there is a one-to-one correspondence between Schur functions and measures on the unit circle. Schur function is related to well-known Schur algorithm in the following way. So if I take the function of zero to be f and define iteratively functions fn by the following formula, then I obtain a family of functions in the unit ball of H infinity. It turns out that there is a following very, very nice formula, which is due to Khrushchev presented here. So the Poisson extension of the following measure, this measure. So let me recall that the polynomials are assumed to be normalized. So this measure, in fact, is a probability measure on the unit circle. So when we consider the Poisson extension of this measure to the unit disk, again we have some kind of relation like this, and in particular its Schur function is defined, and it turns out that we can compute explicitly the Schur function of this measure. So in fact the Schur function will be exactly this ratio where bn is a finite Blaschke product constructed from polynomials phi n. And fn is a function from Schur algorithm. Okay, this is a very important formula. And another thing which, another main instrument which I will use, as you expect, this is our entropy function, which I defined before, and namely its relation to Schur family of probability measure. In fact, we proved with Sergei Denisov quite recently a very nice formula generalizing the classical Ségur formula in the theory of orthogonal polynomials. So this formula is presented here. So in the left-hand side, we have a certain product constructed from sure functions of a measure. In the right-hand side, we have the entropy function. Let me recall once again that k mu of z is the logarithm of p of mu z minus p of logarithm wz. Something which is defined in terms of the measure. So having a measure, we know the right hand side. And it turns out that we have such an equality. And the important fact is that in sure algorithm, we basically know it is completely on one hand, it is completely constructive, but on the other hand, having a measure mu or just a sure function f0, it is very difficult to say something about these iterations fk. So this equality gives us some information. Let me remark that this is indeed the generalization of classical Seguin formula. In fact, classical Seguin formula corresponds just to the case where the point z is just zero. So if we substitute zero to this formula, what do we have? So in the numerator we have one, in the denominator we have one minus fk of zero squared. Now in the right hand side we have the first term just vanishes because the measure is a probability measure, and then we can rewrite this in the more classical form. Like this, just multiply by minus one. In the right hand side, we have so-called Seguin integral, a famous object. In the left hand side, we have such a product. And if you know something about orthogonal polynomials, you can recognize here that this product, in fact, the product of recurrency coefficients of orthogonal polynomials. This is Geronimus theorem. Okay, so for this case, when z is equal to zero, we indeed have the classical Seguin formula. Okay, so let me now, if there are some questions you can ask. If not, I will go to the proof of Matenyi-Wai Totic theorem. This one. So this is our aim. Maybe a couple of words before about applications of this theorem. In fact, this is quite important fact for basically or at least two reasons. The first reason is that at least for a long time, this was a central tool in proving so-called universality limits in random matrix theory. And second important application concerns so-called rate theorem about convergence of orthogonal polynomial expansions. So if you consider a Fourier series with respect to some orthogonal polynomial system, you can ask about its convergence. For example, Chisara convergence almost everywhere on a segment. And this theorem is a tool which is used to prove that at least in Seguin case, we do have a Chisara convergence of orthogonal expansions. So, okay. Now maybe let me go to the proof. It is quite elementary, despite the original proof of Matenyi-Wai and Totic. First of all, I would like to prove the following inequality. So let me consider the first equality is just the mean value theorem for analytic function phi n star d mu. I recalling that d mu is a Seguin function. So the first equality is the mean value theorem. Then I apply Cauchy-Schwarz or Jensen inequality, if you prefer here. And so because this weight is just W, and because WDM is less or equal than D mu, then I can replace it by this this guy here. And now using the Khrushchev theorem, I get the following fraction, which is already quite simple to estimate, and I get this inequality. So this is very elementary fact. Okay, so next fact is the following estimate. Basically the central estimate actually, because it more or less it tells us that this Schur functions in some sense they are small. So recall that the right hand side, I mean there is this, so it basically tends to zero when z approaches to the unit circle. This will be this will be important for us. Okay, so let me prove. Take number n, which will be which is actually an arbitrary number for a moment, and so the first estimate is just an elementary estimate. If you just open the brackets in the right hand side, you will have two terms in the left hand side and something positive. Okay, so the first inequality is trivial. Then I just rearrange the well, I doing some simple calculation, and well, here n will be replaced by infinity, and now in the last step, I use our theorem with Sergei Denisov that we proved. So let me recall the theorem. I use the following thing, that the infinite product is in fact the entropy function. Okay, e to the power entropy function, if you consider the exponentials. So now it remains to consider this to differ one from both sides, and we get the statement of lemma two. The third lemma is in fact quite a standard tool, and now it's standard in Matenyi-Vytautic theorem. It was one of central observations. Also, this is a very elementary fact. If we have a polynomial P in a complex, an analytic polynomial without zeros in the open unit disk of degree at most n, then at each point xi on the unit circle, we have the following estimate. So maybe just a picture. We'll explain the proof. It's very elementary. So if you have zeros here and some point xi here, so usually when we move a little bit inside, then the product will only increase. Actually, I mean, the product of such distances. And more or less an exercise to find what is the extremal case, and you will get the following sharp estimate here. If you have the polynomial of degree at most 10, then you will have power minus 2 and here. So now we can prove everything is ready for the proof of Matteini-Vytautic theorem. So this is what we need to prove, basically. We have polynomials on the unit circle, and we want to prove that we want to prove Chisara convergence at almost every point on the unit circle. And basically, by definition, it is we can take either pk or pk star. Here, it doesn't matter much because of this. Identity. So on the unit circle, we have quality of absolute values. Now, so what we have, let me rewrite this formula in the following form. So using the fact that psi zero is a Lebesgue point of our Segal function, I can rewrite our claim in this form. So the upper limit should be less than e to the power of delta for some delta greater than zero, actually arbitrary. So we can take some number delta and prove this. And the lower limit is strictly bigger than one. So it is enough to prove two claims, one and two. So we consider that these two inequalities separately, and what do we do now? Well, we just use the lemmas that we prepared in the first inequality. We consider VM actually we actually have so there are several steps actually here. First, we change psi zero by some point Zn with some error. This one, this is what we need to pay for this change, and this is because of the last lemma 3. And actually, we can also replace d mu of psi zero by d mu of Zn, where Zn, well, it is this point. This is because Zn is the back point of d mu, of the absolute value of the logarithm, actually. Okay, and now we use a trivial fact that we have the following convergence when n tends to zero, and we can estimate it in the following form, like this. Then use lemma about the such sums. This was the first lemma we proved. Okay, so the first lemma was about such a product. We replace product by this this fraction, and then we more or less make some calculations to get what we have in lemma two. So in lemma two, we have such a sum. We have this sum. which is very close actually to what we have here. So basically, there are two terms. One term is this one, and the other term is this one. And we consider sum of two terms, and one is small because, so maybe it's a little bit complicated here, but basically, so let's look again on the lemma. So lemma two tells you more or less that such a sum is small if the entropy function is small. So, and it means more or less that fk of z should be small in average. And if k of z, if such a sequence is a sequence of small numbers in average, you basically have in this sum more or less sum of one plus something small. In doing a simple calculation, let me skip it, you get eventually the following estimate, where delta is a positive number and the upper limit of a remaining term is zero, because almost everywhere the entropy function tends to zero. And basically, this is the proof, more or less the proof of the theorem, because the lower estimate is quite easy. You just need to use the fact that such a sum is somehow normalized reproducing kernel. The norm of this sum is just the squared norm of reproducing kernel divided by n. And well, using the fact that the reproducing kernel is a certain supremum, yes, variational principle, you just substitute a very concrete polynomial which works for Lebesgue measure, and you get a lower estimate. So it's pretty easy. You will get at the end integral of this form. And so if you look at this guy, you just recognize that this is a fair kernel of order n. And because fair means converge to the density of W at almost every point, you get the result. So it is easy to see that what we use is that, that Xi zero is just a Lebesgue point of W and logarithm of W. In the initial proof, it was the Lebesgue point of D mu, which is a little bit more complicated condition to check. Also, if the measure, if the weight is separated from, if it is continuous and if it is non-vanishing weight, then it is very easy to check that the convergence will hold uniformly on the unit circle. So this is basically all what I plan to present you. So maybe once again, Matheny-Vytautic theorem. From 1991. Initially, it was quite a delicate argument, and I hope you feel now that the proof is not so difficult as it was expected for 30 years. also as an application in my work where I proof it, it's very easy to find on archive. So in my work, I apply this entropy function to prove something about Freud theorem for CMV orthogonal polynomials. This is just another application in the line of classical applications of Matheny-Vytautic theorem. So thank you very much for your attention. Sorry again for delay. If you have questions, you can ask.
Thank you very much. And we have time for questions, comments.
Can I ask one question? So, Roman, as far as I know, Totic later on then generalized their result to more complicated sets, say finite gap sets or something, using polynomial pre-images. Do you think, but this is still a lot of computational effort, do you believe that your methods could be also used to pass to other sets in the whole unit circle using some covering formalism or something?
I think it is a very interesting direction. I do not have any concrete result, but for me it's very interesting already for two intervals. So suppose you have Segyo class not on one interval but on several intervals. So what is the right object here? So instead of this entropy function, you probably can write something else, but with more or less the same properties. Or okay, I did not list it all the properties, but well, somehow I believe that there should be a right analog, and maybe it could be used to prove some classical or even new asymptotic results. But this is a completely open direction. I even did not start it to think.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Other questions? If not, then let's thank our speaker again.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. And we'll see.